the very brief introduction about the book. To me, what is interesting, probably by addition, to me, maybe we find something else interesting, but to me, this is more interesting. What do I do with a sovereignty conflict? First of all, and that has to do with Rothian methodology, I'm going to set the rule for the negotiation. I'm going to talk about two sovereign states and a populated third territory. Yes, that's my assumption, first of all. We may use, by analogy, this same example in different contexts. Yes, we may use it for Antarctica, we may use it for indigenous people, other kinds of sovereignty. We may use it, I've been asking Mexico whether we could use that now with Trump. In Mexico, I was asking, that was a very interesting question. The border between America, or the United States of America, and Mexico. You can use by analogy this, when I'm going to explain what I mean by this methodology. That was not my intention. That has come with the public by presenting this in different countries. I've gained quite a lot in terms of information. The main addition I see, pluralism, I'm not going to refer to some of these elements. I'm going to assume limited resources like roles. We have only two Malvinas Islands or Falkland Islands. We have only one Hong Kong, or if you wish, the islands around. We have only one Kashmir, so we are rather limited in terms of sovereignty conflict. Why I'm saying this? We tend to assume sovereignty as a very clear concept. I'm not redefining the concept. Yeah. What I'm accepting is that this concept has different layers. Sovereignty is not a matter only of natural resources. Sovereignty is not a matter only of human rights. Sovereignty is not a matter of border, location, defense. Sovereignty is a very complex issue. So depending on our political speech, we may target natural resources, oil. I may target human rights because I need to justify my decision to invade this country or to take Crimea. Yes. However, sovereignty is much more. So what I'm going to try to do is to divide in Spanish, we say torta miloca, a sort of cake with different layers, to try to divide these layers, the complexity in sovereignty, into different portions. First of all, I have to, this is very briefly, and I'm going to assume that people are not selfish, but they are self-centered. Same, the states. Trump is not selfish, he's self-centered. He's thinking of the interest of America. That's what I am going to assume. Putin is not selfish, he's self-centered. He's only thinking about Russians as main interest. That's why I talk about plan of life in terms of the state. I assume Russia wants Crimea for themselves. I assume India wants Kashmir for themselves and so on. Once again, not selfish, self-centered. Who may be part of these negotiations? We have concepts in international law. We tend to miss people, to meet the most important people, the people that live in the territory. Falkland, Malvinas, and Alanya do not have the right to participate. Kashmirians do not have the right to decide about their future. I learned in Colombia, when I presented in Colombia, San Andres, island between Nicaragua and Colombia, no one asked people in San Andres what they want. No, to be that, I'm not surprised. I'm from Argentina, we don't ask people in the Falkland what they want. It's very simple. So to me, if I go to international public law, I'm a lawyer, I know this answer, but just to, you know, for people that are not lawyers. We have certain elements that legitimize a position in order for me to claim sovereignty. What I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce a broader concept. I borrow from criminal law in America, in the United States, and from Scotland. Colorado claim. You may come to the negotiations about sovereignty if you have a Colorado claim. What do I mean by Colorado claim? I'll leave service legitimacy in order to argue whether you're a sovereign. Not that you have a claim to sovereignty, not that you have the right to sovereignty, that at least you have a certain element that may make your potential claim actual, real. And I give three cases. International law, the examples I put here, international public law, effective occupation, concept by one of the parties, international law, that's international public law today. I deal as well with the historical entitlement. People may think about Argentina being removed. At the time we were not Argentina, they were removed by force from the Falkland. But we can think of Tibet, it's not only, there are many cases. You know, the one I'm more interested in right now is Tibet. Tibetans have been removed from the region. Even people in Hong Kong have been bit by bit removed. People don't know that, but I was teaching in Hong Kong a few months ago, I presented this idea, and I learned that even in Hong Kong, right now, there are things going on that are not on the news, they are not popular, they're not selling. And we haven't solved Hong Kong, by the way, there are still problems there. And then I'm going to add a third example, the moral standing. What I'm trying to do with that, in terms of cholera, claim. People that live in these places, any decision will affect them directly. Any decision will affect them directly. Whether you are going to be part of Argentina or the UK, whether you are going in Gibraltar, you are going to be part of Spain or the UK, whether you are going to be part of Pakistan, India or China, in the case of Kashmir, and so on. The ones that are going to live through the consequences in terms of natural resources, criminal law, civil law, think of the penalty, yes? So any consequences, whether that criminal law is harsher or not, whether I'm going to have access to free education or not, whether I'm going to have access to healthcare or not, those consequences may be lived indirectly by the other population, the British or the Britons, the Argentinians, the Spaniards, and so on. But the ones that are going to live the consequences of any decisions are the people that live in those places. And not only them, future generations, their children, their grandchildren are going to live through any of the consequences. What I'm trying to claim here is that at least they have a colorable claim based on moral standing in order to be part of any or in any negotiations. I deal with four parties, let's say, I put the example of Zimbabwe, whether they would have a claim to Falklands. Once again, that I make clear, this is a project to use distributive justice solution to sovereignty conflict, and not the other way around. I'm not using sovereignty to finish inequality. Potentially, I mean, there is room to play with that. I would be interested to hear, you know, the obvious how you may adapt. Potentially, there is room. But my definition of this game is distributive justice to put a solution to sovereignty claim. Now that we move here, I'm going to use the Maximian, I can explain that later. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to introduce to these parties a menu, what kind of options they may have to argue about. The one I'm going to refer very briefly, I'm going to discuss the different principles, the equality principle, the principle that focus on the third party. The main one I'm going to talk about is the just acquisition. We tend to see in any of these sovereignty conflicts, I take three as a target, Kashmir, Falklands, and Gibraltar. Chapter 7, has to do with the historical entitlement. But I show any of the representatives that will be part of the negotiation will have two main restrictions. I'm going to disagree here with Rawls. The members, they will have access to all information, even their emotions. Yes? The main restrictions I'm going to put to this party, the representative, they don't know who they represent in order to avoid any bias. And they are not going to know certain only two elements about themselves, their religion and their ethnical background. Simply because I have to think of cases as Kashmir, in which, or Jerusalem, in which the main component is religion. The rest, they have access to everything. If they have access to everything, I maintain, and I use theodosic to talk about the historical entitlement, who came first to the Falklands, or who settled first in Kashmir or in Jerusalem. Very, very briefly, what I'm going to show here, this is not a matter of fact. I mean, our government knows this. Even though we may agree, and I take it to the extent, even though we may agree on the chronology of the fact, the French saw the island first, whether India had population first, that's not the problem. This is the problem for philosophers of justice. Which of these several facts will give me the entitlement for the claim? Is it the fact that my people saw the island first? Is it the fact that I put the first flag? Is it the fact that I had the first population settled there? Our government knows this. This is not about the chronology. We tend to play with people, telling them, I don't know, I cannot prove who came first to Jerusalem. That's not the problem. We know that. We know that. In the evaluation of those problems. So rational parties, and I define these parties as well, they are reasonable, they are free, and so on, so I define them. I'm missing quite a few elements, but reasonable people or reasonable parties would disagree and wouldn't take on board this kind of solution, the historical entitlement. I'm asking, by the way, I didn't say this in order to wrap up this. I'm asking these negotiators, representatives, to choose a solution that no reasonable party can reject. I'm asking the bare minimum. I follow, I use Keynes theory as well, I use David Gauthier for this. I'm not asking the parties to accept. I'm asking at least that they could tell me that any reasonable party would be unable to reject the outcome. So the outcome, what I'm trying to do here, although this is Cinderella, this is fiction, what I'm trying to show, reasonable parties will be able to talk. Reasonable parties will be able to listen to each other. Reasonable parties could come up with an agreement, even though they may disagree, and even though they may not sign the actual end of the question. What I'm going to do, I'm going to put a preliminary requirement because I'm going to come up with a solution. Bracket here, I'm not interested, thank you. I'm not interested, 2 minutes and I promise I finish. I'm not interested in offering the solution, I'm going to offer a solution. I'm interested in procedural justice. If the same parties come up with autonomy, self-determination, any of the solutions, I will be happy with that. To me, the procedural justice. Why? Because I try to offer equal footing, equal standing at the start. The main preliminary requirement, the prime directive, like in Star Trek. Why? Because I see in the UK they tend to sell abroad inclusion. They don't include, they assimilate, which is very different. I accept you if you behave the way I behave. That is, in my dictionary, not inclusion, but assimilation. So I'm trying to avoid this kind of thing. We've seen it in China, we've seen it in India, we've seen it in Latin America, we've seen it in Africa. And I think we're at the point that we need to change the game here, or the rules of the game. And that's why I think any reasonable party would first of all accept preliminary requirements. And then I'm offering the solution, what I call egalitarian shared sovereignty. I'm not going to have time to, I told you 2 minutes after I was done with that, but this is the solution I offer. And then I put in chapter 7, I take the concept, the very basic concept of state, a people, population in a territory with a common government. I take each of the elements and I show how my theory applies to 3 cases. And how sovereignty is very rich, it's not only human nature, it's not only natural resources, it's not only a question of numbers. In terms of population, I show with Kashmir. How many religion and so on, and how you can apply to different elements or sub-elements in sovereignty, my theory or my methodology. In terms of territory, I use the Falklands, Malvinas, and I apply it to defense, to natural resources, and so on. And in terms of government, here I use Kelsen. I deal with Gibraltar. And I think of whether to share in or to share out sovereignty, whether all the parties should be part of all the power of the creation, application, an execution of the law, or whether they need to distribute that. And I show through Kelsen, legal theory, hardcore legal theory, that we need to share in sovereignty. Because if not, we would have conflict in law. It's as simple as. To wrap up, the main complaint I may have, or the main criticism, this is theory. Yes, it's ideal theory, pure idea theory. If I wait for the party to put the solution, I'm going to die before seeing a solution to Jerusalem, Falkland, Kashmir, and so on. Why? Because there are particular interests here. We all know that. It seems to me, and I tend to go to congresses and we talk about problems. Yes, and I'm a bit sick of going to congresses and talk about problems. We all know these problems. Why don't we start thinking about solutions? That's why the book, and that's why the intention of the book. Thank you very much for listening.